Daily Tech News Show is made possible by you, its listeners. Thanks to all of you, including Johnny Hernandez, High Tech Oki, Chris Zaragoza, and everybody, welcome our new patron, Jason. On this episode of DTNS, competition kills Jabra earbuds, eventually. New advances in the science of water purification involves beetles, sort of. And is Apple really not paying OpenAI for access to its AI models in iOS 18? We're going to break it down. This is the Daily Tech News for Thursday, June 13th, 2024. From Studio Animal House, I'm Sarah Lane.
From Columbus, Ohio, I'm Robb Dunewood.
From deep in the heart of Texas, I'm Justin Robert Young.
And I'm the show's producer, Roger Chang.
We've got a good show for you all today, and we're going to start that show off with the quick hits. Yahoo debuted a new version of the Yahoo News app powered by underlying code from the Artifact Newsreader app, which Yahoo acquired back in April. You might recall that Artifact launched back in 2023 by Instagram co-founders Kevin Systrom and Mike Krieger. Artifact is now part of the Yahoo News app and makes heavy use of AI using algorithms to serve its readers highly personalized content based on what news stories they engage with and have engaged with in the past. The Yahoo News app is currently free on both Android and iOS.
WhatsApp updated its video calling experience across devices by introducing screen sharing with audio support and a new speaker spotlight feature. WhatsApp is also increasing the limit of video call participants up to 32 people and will now also allow users to have up to 32 people on a single video call across devices. Prior to this update, WhatsApp had a 32 participant limit on mobile devices, but Windows and Mac OS users could only use 16 and 8 participants respectively.
Japan's parliament enacted a law on Wednesday aimed at promoting competition in smartphone app store sales by restricting Apple and Google from limiting third-party companies from selling and operating apps on their platforms. So the new law prohibits iOS and Android operating systems from preventing the sale of apps and services that directly compete with the native platform's own and will prohibit Apple and Google from giving priority to their own services in internet search results.
Amazon Web Services has introduced passkeys as a new method for multi-factor authentication and remind users that root AWS accounts must enable MFA by the end of July 2024. Passkeys leverage public key cryptography to sign a challenge sent by the server used for verifying the authentication attempt. They are less vulnerable than one-time passwords to phishing and man-in-the-middle attacks, are syncable, and support multiple device and OS architectures. Amazon says customers can unlock passkeys through Apple Touch ID on the iPhone, Windows Hello on Windows laptops, and other platforms that support passkeys.
A site called EpicDB that tracks titles in the Epic Games library may have just leaked a ton of upcoming games, as first reported by WCCF Tech. EpicDB was taken offline shortly after it posted information scraped from the Epic Games Store catalog on Monday, but then other publishers like Bethesda, Sega, Sony, Square Enix, and others were included in a series of screenshots posted by a user on a Reset Era forum, some under apparent code names. Epic Games tells The Verge, quote, "We released an update tonight so third-party tools can't surface any new unpublished product titles from the Epic Games Store catalog." All right, everybody have some liquor because we have to pour one out for Jabra, who is exiting the consumer earbuds business. This was very, very surprising to me, and here's why. So the announcement from Jabra comes right at the same time that it unveiled new models of its earbuds, the Jabra Elite 10 and Elite 8 active earbuds that are due later this month. Look good, sound good, you know, everything seems good. Peter Kallstromer, CEO of Jabra's parent company, GN, says the decision to wind down the earbuds business in general was, quote, "part of our commitment to focus on attractive markets where we can deliver profitable growth and strong returns." So obviously, the earbud market, not part of that. The Jabra Elite consumer line will be discontinued, as well as the Talk, which is the mono Bluetooth product line. Back in 2023, late 2023 of last year, Jabra more or less pivoted the Elite line towards the premium segment in a move designed to compete with Apple and Sony and Bose. And there are others as well. Jabra also says its target markets have changed over time. The company will reduce the inventory of soon-to-be-discontinued products over the rest of the year. But, again, parent company GN says it will service and support its devices for several years. So if you want to buy one of those new earbuds, I guess you have several years from today.
No way that I would be willing to buy them now, knowing that they're going to stop, making them. But I have to say, I was kind of surprised by this because I'm a fan of Jabra earbuds. I'm looking at them right now. I have the Jabra 75T, Elite 75T, the Elite 85T, and another pair of older ones. I just can't remember what the name of them are, but
probably 65T, which is what I have.
Yeah, so they all work just fine. They do what they're supposed to do, and I just assumed that they were doing okay because they have repeat customers like me that go back and get them every couple of years.
Yeah,
but ultimately, this is a field that has changed a lot. Not only has it gotten more crowded at the top end, where you've had AirPods like I'm wearing right now that have been tied closer and closer to the hardware of the devices themselves, but also we live in a post-Wish Timu world where the concept of wireless earbuds are very, very cheap. So either, at the top end, it's closer tied in because it is integrated with the hardware. At the low end, you're not going to out-cheap the cheapy peepee stuff that's out there in the market. And so if you're in the mushy middle, it's hard. It's hard for something that needs to come in at a certain level price-wise to make it worth your while. But those margins are evaporating unless you're at the absolute elite pinnacle, and Jabra doesn't feel like that's their market.
Yeah, I reviewed the 65Ts, the Jabras, for Live With It back in, I think, 2019. And at the time, there were AirPods, but it was, to get Jabra earbuds was like, okay, you care about audio quality and form factor and all of that stuff. And yeah, it sort of seems like Jabra was in that kind of weird sweet spot of being directly competing with Apple, where, you can't win, or just too expensive to compete with the lower priced earbuds, of which there are many.
Yeah, I have had a lot of earbuds over the years just because I tend to lose them. So I've bought a lot, but you're right. My kids and even my wife, until I just got her some really good ones that have ear loops on them, so hopefully she won't lose them. they would buy the cheapest one, $10-$15 online. It's like if they stop working or you sweat and one goes out, you just go and buy another pair for $10 or $15. So I could see where if they are having to compete at the high end with the manufacturers named Apple and Samsung who make their own, and then you've got the Bose and the Sony that are kind of known for quality audio equipment, it would be hard for them to compete. So that makes sense. But I'm definitely pouring one out because I have three pair that still work and a fourth pair that one works. The other one I'm assuming work. I just don't know where it is. I lost it somewhere.
Well, you're gonna have service for another couple of years. So, you're good.
Let's also say we don't know the ins and outs of this. This could we're assuming that it's just the fact that they're sitting in the middle of the street that they're getting run over. But this might be malfeasance from the company that is trying to overestimate another sector that's not going to come through in the same way. That being said, it is rare for a brand like that to stay around. And it is a bummer of our modern supply chain challenged world that they couldn't compete here.
And, whether it's a bummer for the company, but for Jabra to be like, new earbuds, best ever. And by the way, we're winding this down.
Yeah.
This reminds me of when I bought a Saab. And then the company was like, oh, we don't do that anymore. So
enjoy.
You just have a car that won't be serviced, unless you pay up the ying, at some third party. Anyway. Yeah. Still salty about that. Okay. Well, let's move on to Western Africa. So along the coastal desert of southwestern Africa lives the Namib Desert beetle. The beetle gets its water from collecting water droplets that form on its body from the moisture in the air. You might be saying, how in the heck is this going to relate to tech? Robb, take us in.
Well, a company you may have heard of, Car Water, has designed a product that can collect water from the air and purify it for drinking, winning an innovation award at CES in 2023. The technology and the name of the company is inspired by that very same beetle. The name Car is derived from the beetle's scientific name. Tom talked to the founder of Car Water, Cody Sodin, who on a Word with Tom Merritt, and they actually talked about how this thing works. So they broke it down, and we're going to go ahead and listen now.
So tell me how Car Water works. Like, how does the beetle do it that inspired this? And how does the machine that you've made do it?
Honestly, it's the exact same process. It's super cool. And the science behind it is called biomimicry. It's in replicating nature's function, not the aesthetic. So like solar panels replicate leaves, like photosynthesizing, right? Kind of same concept. The beetle has, if you look closely at its shell, which is what I started researching after learning about it, the shell of the beetle has these little bumps and these little valleys. The bumps have a coating that's similar to the stuff that you find in your shoebox, that little packet, silica. It naturally adapted to produce silica on its shell. On the valleys, it has something like Teflon. Do you know how if you drop water in a Teflon pan, it just beads up?
It just beads up, yeah.
Right, so the valleys have Teflon. So as the water sticks to the bumps, it's not enough water to become subject to gravity, but if it breaks the surface tension of that bump, it'll roll over the Teflon area. So it just slides to the next bump that has water and starts to continue to collect as it's sliding over these valleys, collecting on these bumps, eventually forming enough water for the beetle to tip itself over and do a handstand and drink the water off its own back. So it really came down to like, wow, we have these natural materials already available to us, Teflon and silica. We don't have Teflon or stuff in our product, but it's the concept of being able to capture the water. How we extract it is what makes it unique. We actually distill it off of the desiccant. So we have to heat it to remove it, which actually purifies the water because you're distilling it now. We create like this pseudo steam, and then we recondense it with just a natural airflow that causes a small temperature differential to recondense it. And then we collect that water and we sterilize it in UV tanks and then add minerals back to it. So that's how we get to the natural pH of 9.2, high mineral rich water. And then you just have 10 liters per day made in your home or your office.
Does it matter how humid an area you're in? I imagine where I grew up in Southern Illinois, it would work great in the summer. But what about Arizona?
Yeah, Arizona. So the quote that I mentioned of people saying that it works in desert environments is from Arizona. It's in Scottsdale, Arizona, one of our vocal customers. I visited them. They live in the middle of a desert. Like I couldn't tell you, it's nothing else but a desert. He has one at his house and at his office. And he just texted me the other day and he goes, hey, I've had Car Pure in my house for a year now, and I've never once run out of water. Great testimony for Scottsdale, Arizona. And I asked him just to really get some data. I said, how much do you think that you and your family drink per day? He goes, about 3 to 5 liters. I go, have you ever run out? Has the machine like ever said that it was empty after the end of the day? He's like, no. So I put 2 and 2 together and I was like, well, there must still be some extra water in there after drinking 3 to 5 liters, maybe another liter or two, meaning up to 7 liters per day. So in a desert environment, it still operates at 70% efficient.
There's that much water, even in a desert air, for it to extract. That's
well, I would say it's the technology itself. It has this ability to constantly extract water from the air because of us keeping it dry. We take out the humidity or the saturation, so we keep it 0% saturated.
So it dehumidifies your area too, but which can be a great thing. But would it ever be something where you don't want to have it in a room because of that?
So there's a couple factors that play into how well it operates. One is the size of the room that you have it in. We found that to be very effective because the amount of volume you have is more water in the air, right? So the size of the space really matters. So we tell you not to like put into a closet. If you put it into a room with no windows, it's not going to perform as well. But if the room is big enough, it'll perform just fine. So things like that tend to play into how efficient it is.
Is that because windows are permeable that needs them? Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So there is some air transfer between windows, even if they're not operable. So he has in his office in his conference room that doesn't have operable windows, but it's like up against the window. So it's mm-hmm. never out of the water. And he has about 12 or 13 employees. So I was like, that's a great, you know, way to operate it in those environments. What we do say is we'll see like a 5% drop in humidity in like a high humid place, maybe like a 2-3% in a lower humid place, because there's a lot of water in the air, regardless of where you live. So you're never going to run out too much, and it goes into standby.
Kara is currently sold out, but you can reserve a future version at karawater.com. They sell for $4,899 or around $238 per month if you want to spread out the payments with 0% financing. You can hear the full interview on the latest episode of A Word with Tom Merritt at awordpodcast.com. By the way, did you know that Tom has a newsletter of tech news from his perspective that gets delivered to your inbox every morning? I read it. Newsflash, he does. And he's making it a free preview for all subscribers this week. Usually everybody gets it free on Thursday, but it's free all week for everybody. So just head to freetechnewsletter.com.
Bloomberg's Mark Gurman reports that following the news that Apple will use OpenAI technology in its upcoming iOS 18, neither Apple nor OpenAI is paying the other for placing ChatGPT into Apple's ecosystem. Apple reportedly thinks that exposure OpenAI will receive from being on hundreds of millions of Apple devices is of equal or greater value than monetary payments. Apple will utilize OpenAI's GPT-4o model to power various AI tasks on iOS 18, iPadOS 18, and macOS Sequoia, but the deal is not exclusive to OpenAI. Apple is still in talks with Anthropic and Google to offer their perspective, or should say respective chatbots, as an alternative option, with some sort of agreement for Google's Gemini expected to be in place later this year. So Justin, is this a legitimate distribution model for ChatGPT? Normally, as a creator, I would say I'm not interested in doing things for free, but they are going to be installed on somewhere south of a billion devices. That might change things.
With all respect to us as independent creators who are very, very entitled to everything that we get for our hard work, this is a little bit more of a complex situation when it comes to exposure, although obviously that is a trigger word for many. I was surprised. The idea that I had coming out of that announcement was that Apple was paying OpenAI and that was kind of that they were going to have to shop retail to make up for the fact that they were behind in this world. And they were going to be the first ubiquitous device to put that kind of AI built into the OS going forward, with OpenAI being essentially its preferred chatbot should the system within Apple Intelligence not get you to where you need to go. That being said, if this is looked at by Apple as, hey, you guys are the new search engines. And I don't know if you've seen the reporting, but Google pays us in the billions yearly to maintain their position as the default search engine in Safari because they believe it is that worthwhile to their business. Then ChatGPT, congratulations, the first one's free. Come on in here. You're going to get a ton of data based on the usage that people have. This is an AI rollout to the normies, the likes of which you'd never be able to do by yourself. But going forward, just know there's going to be other options. And at a certain point, you're going to have people that are possibly even Google that will want to pay a pretty penny to be in that top spot.
Yeah, I think that Google will back up a Brinks truck if they put Gemini on here. So I was shocked too that there was no money that was exchanged, between these two companies. But then as I'm reading it and I'm thinking about it and I've looked at a couple other people's comments on this, I'm kind of thinking that Apple is playing, I don't even want to say it's a long game, because I think this game might be like end of year type of game, to where saying, hey, we're just going to show up on nearly a billion devices and let the bidding begin when Anthropic gets into the game, when Google probably is going to get into the game later this year. I think that there is going to be a bidding war. And, you know, that's where this is ultimately going to end up, because Google has to win here. You know, search is their thing. And if even if ChatGPT was able to take 5%, 10% away, that is probably billions of dollars. You know, I wouldn't even say per year, probably per quarter, as far as Google is concerned, you know, with their revenue. So they've got to win. So I'm just wondering, is Apple just setting up a bidding war for some time later this year?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know that Apple really cares to do that with Google. I feel like, you know, Apple's kind of on its, you know, on the playground. Apple's like, I'm doing my thing over in the corner. And Google, Microsoft, and other companies feel like they're a little bit more in, you know, the game of like, okay, who's going to win here? Apple's like, I don't even want to deal with you guys. I'm doing my own thing.
Well, Apple would like to get paid for somebody to try to get that market share, because that's what they have done with search, while they have not built a search competitor. And Robb, I think that you are dead on. There was a buzz a few months ago about OpenAI building a search competitor to Google. They have a search competitor. It's called ChatGPT. And the more people rely on it, we are looking at a world in which the changing behavior is going to tilt more toward asking generative AI to find search results for you, with what we understand as search now to be looked at as kind of archaic. That's where the market is going. There's a reason why it feels like we always wind up getting back to the existential threat that this does represent to Google and its AdWords empire. But I'm very fascinated by this. Also, it does, to me, make the stories a few weeks ago make a little bit more sense that Microsoft was not in love with this deal, because the world in which OpenAI was getting paid by Apple to be a vendor for their OS was, that seemed like a win-win for everybody. If there's no money involved here, I can see a little bit more reaction from Washington State.
I can see some of my friends who were just diehard Windows Phone fans saying, see, this is why you should have never gave up your phone, Microsoft. But yeah, if I were Microsoft, if not upset, my eyebrows at least would have been raised. Like, wait a minute, you're going to let them install this for free? You're not paying them anything to put this on your phone, or you're not getting paid anything by them to put this on your phone? That's an interesting juxtaposition, I think, that Microsoft is thinking about right now. But I'll go back to Google. Google's world is search. And if search becomes what you do in a chat bot,
It is AdWords. AdWords, yeah. On search.
Yes, AdWords, yeah. On search. They have to win here. So yeah. I'm just wondering, is this just a good play to get a bucket of money out of Google from an Apple standpoint?
But here's the other thing, though, Robb. They haven't figured out AdWords on search for Gemini. So that's like, this is existential. But they might be kind of screwed either way. Because let's say that they're chasing this concept. And unless, you know, AGI comes along and now you can offer an entire suite of new things. But even then, you're betting on a new business model. Right now, Google is degrading its AdWord offering by putting answers to questions above stuff without even saying whether or not those answers are good or not, which was a scandal, you know, 2 weeks ago. But they need to figure that out. That's the thing. AdWords are the goose that laid the golden eggs for them. It is 100% margin, essentially. And right now, where the future is going, there's no clean install for the thing that makes them all their money.
Well, moving on to the mailbag. Feedback at dailytechnewsshow.com, by the way, is where to send your email going forward. Nathan says he was surprised that our cloud gaming conversation didn't come up in our conversation when looking at the differences between the two Xboxes. Basically, the big 2 terabyte Xbox having a disk offering, and the new white one not having one. Nathan says, I would imagine the cheaper Xbox with a smaller disk size is made for those who are embracing Xbox Game Pass and their cloud gaming features, which allow you to play games without installing. As this is a new and more modern way of playing games, the old guard are probably still a little bit more reliant on discs and prefer to have physical discs. To me, it would make sense that they would need larger storage and an optical disc drive, while the model without a disc drive is geared towards those with a use case requiring less storage. As a side note, I think it was prime Sherlocking when Windows started natively supporting zip compression. By WinZip, or when they started supporting ISO mounting, by Daemon Tools, by Magic ISO.
And speaking of Sherlocking, Mary, who goes by MP Blanton on Twitch, writes, Microsoft tried to Sherlock screen reader technology in Windows 7 with the introduction of Narrator. Windows Eyes went away after Windows 8. JAWS is a very expensive product, but works very well if you can afford it. NVDA is about the only other option. My husband says Microsoft hasn't really updated Narrator much, while JAWS and NVDA get regular updates. A good screen reader is vital for blind or seriously visually impaired persons to use a computer, tablet, or smartphone.
Oh, Mary and Nathan, thank you so much for writing in. It's always good to get stuff from the ground from folks who, you know, have heard what we're talking about, have some real world ideas about how it could be better, and we appreciate that. Again, feedback at dailytechnewsshow.com is where to send that email. Justin Robert Young,
yes.
Thank you for being with us today. Besides almost having a little Justin, what's up in your world?
Well, the Politics podcast, folks, you can go ahead and download it wherever you get your podcast, and on YouTube. That's what I would love for people to go check out. YouTube.com/@politics. Everything that we do, all the political news, but with my face.
Excellent. Patrons, stick around for our extended show, Good Day Internet. We're going to talk a little bit more about that new iPhone iOS 18 feature where you can get satellite internet. Where would that be good for you and when? We'll talk about it in a few.
You can also catch the show live Monday through Friday at 4 p.m. Eastern, 2000 UTC. Find out more at dailytechnewsshow.com/live. We'll be back tomorrow with Molly Wood.
Woo-woo! Talk to you then.
The DTNS family of podcasts. Helping each other understand.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.